Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Krista Lemelin. I am the designated federal officer for the National Archives and Records Administration's Freedom of Information Act Advisory Committee. It's my honor today to introduce the 10th Archivist of the United States, David Barrio, to give introductory remarks. My mother will be especially excited that I get to introduce you because, as you know, you and I are both North Shore, Massachusetts natives, and every time you visit our great state, my mother clips news articles about you and sends them to me. So thank you, sir, for doing me this great honor and for welcoming us all to your room and for being such a great supporter of this committee and the work that we do.
Thank you, thank you. We are graduates of the same high school, actually. Not the same year, but the same high school. So welcome. It's a very exciting day as we introduce James Holzer for his very first meeting here as the director of OGIS. And in your honor, just a housekeeping detail that we'll clarify right away, the restrooms at either end of the building are open for the first time for your meeting, so you don't have to go downstairs. I just discovered this morning that we hadn't made arrangements for that. So just a few words, you all know James, but just a few words of introduction of who he is and where he came from and why I selected him to head this very important part of our mission here at the National Archives. James comes to us from the Department of Homeland Security, where he served as Senior Director of FOIA and led several initiatives that improved the agency's FOIA process and the requester's experience. Considering his impressive work with FOIA issues, I'm sure his is a familiar face to you. I'm glad James has joined us as he has an opportunity to help improve the administration of FOIA across federal government. And I also sought the input of several members of the open government community in making this appointment. So I'm pleased that James has joined us. You also have a unique opportunity to make recommendations for change that reflect the needs both of the FOIA requester community and federal agencies. I know that many across the FOIA landscape are looking to you for suggestions to improve the FOIA process. It's a process that remains, as Senator Patrick Leahy has called it, the cornerstone of democracy. This month, the National Archives joins libraries, archives, and educational institutions and historical societies across the nation celebrating American Archives Month. This annual celebration highlights the importance of public access to records, and your work directly supports such efforts. As the nation's record keeper, we here at the National Archives are grateful for the opportunity to support the work of this committee, and we look forward to following your progress in the months ahead. Before you leave today, I hope you'll take an opportunity to wander across to the other side of the building and take a look at the Charters of Freedom. In the rotunda, they're always it's always a special moment for me when I have an opportunity to walk in and pay attention to who's there and watch the American public have interaction with our founding documents. It's always a moving experience. And if you want to be totally moved, go over to the O'Brien Gallery to see our Spirited Republic exhibit, which talks about the government's role in alcohol. It's a very disturbing and a very on one hand, a very exciting exhibit for you to learn about your government and its actions. Just a preview of next spring, our next big exhibit coming up is one where we've entitled Amending America, and it deals with the 11,000 attempts to amend the Constitution. So that's going to be a very, very interesting exhibit. And I'll be staying with you for a part of this morning's meeting.
Great, thank you. So, thank you all for joining us today for our sixth FOIA Advisory Committee meeting and my first meeting as committee chair. I know you all join me in thanking the National Archives and Records Administration for hosting these committee meetings, and I want to give a special thanks to the archivists for the kind remarks. As it's already been said, I'm James Holzer, I'm the director of OGIS, and I'm the chair of this committee. Prior to joining OGIS in August of this year, I served as the senior director at DHS, and in that position, I was the senior advisor to the department's executive level leadership. on FOIA compliance. I also led the implementation of the department's enterprise-wide FOIA tracking, processing, and case management system, and supervised a team of FOIA professionals performing various program activities that often involved unique and sensitive FOIA matters relating to FOIA administration. I'm very happy to be a part of the National Archives. It's an agency that's dedicated to driving openness, cultivating public participation, and strengthening our nation's democracy through public access to government records. I'm excited to be working with this committee, comprised of government and non-government experts. As committee chair, I look forward to working with you to ensure our efforts have an impact across the executive branch and to help improve the FOIA process for agencies and requesters alike. We would like to spend the next few minutes introducing the committee members who are around the table and on the telephone. Committee members Maggie Mulville and Ann Weissman and Ramona Branch Oliver are unable to join us today due to previous commitments, and actually Ann is sick. So we'll look forward to seeing them at our next meeting in January. As a reminder, the committee's biographies are available on our website at www.ojas.archives.gov. We are videotaping this meeting and we'll make the video transcript and meeting materials available on the committee's webpage. So, for the record, please identify yourself by name and affiliation when you speak. So let's start with the members we expect to have on the telephone. I'll ask each of you to introduce yourselves and remind the group of your profession and affiliation. Dave Barr.
Good morning. Dave Barr, out here in Eugene, Oregon. I'm an attorney in private practice, and I represent public information requesters all around the country.
Thank you. Andrew Becker.
I'm a reporter with the Center for Investigative Reporting in the San Francisco Bay Area.
Karen Finnegan.
Hi, this is Karen Finnegan. I'm calling from the State Department.
Thank you for joining us, Karen. Eric Gillespie.
Eric Gillespie, I'm the CEO of Gavini, a big data and information business that focuses on transparent and open government data.
Thank you very much. And now we'll hear from those of you in the room. Again, I'll ask you to introduce yourself and remind the group about your profession. We are going to start on my left with Dave.
David Pritzker, Administrative Conference of the United States, a small federal agency where I'm Deputy General Counsel, and also, not incidentally, FOIA Public Liaison.
Hi, good morning. My name is Marty Michalowski. I'm the Deputy Chief Administrative Officer for the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau.
Hi, good morning. My name is Brent Evan. I'm the Deputy General Counsel at the Defense Intelligence Agency.
Good morning. I'm Jim Hogan. I'm Chief of DoD FOIA Policy within the Directorate for Oversight and Compliance, Department of Defense.
Nate Jones, Director of the FOIA Project at National Security Archive.
Melanie Pastey, Director of the Office of Information Policy at DOJ.
Dolores Barber, Deputy Chief FOIA Officer, DHS.
Sean Moulton, Open Government Project Manager at the Project for Government Oversight.
Lee White, Executive Director of the National Coalition for History.
Mark Zaid, a private practitioner and the Executive Director of the James Madison Project.
Thank you very much. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Marty. You just got a promotion, all right? Taking on a little bit bigger role, like a little bit wider role over there?
I used to be the FOIA manager. Now I'm the Deputy Administrative Officer, so now I'm over FOIA records, security, privacy, and library.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
Okay. Let me also introduce members of our OGIS staff as well who support the committee's operations. Krista Lemelin, she's the committee's designated federal officer. Amy Bennett is live tweeting the meeting this morning. Nikki Gramian, my deputy. Our general counsel staff, who I'm not seeing, but Jean White and Elena Simo. And I'd also like to thank the chief operating officer as well, James Senko, who has provided some support recently on some of these survey issues that we face. So before we get started, let's just provide you some our general agenda and cover basic expectations for today's meetings. We'll take one 15-minute break halfway through this meeting, approximately at 11:30. And although food and drink are not permitted in this room, you may purchase food downstairs in the Charter's Cafe, which is located two levels down. My remarks said the restrooms are also down there, but as the archivist pointed out, you cannot use the restrooms up here. So,
and one more revision, you can have food in there.
Okay, we can have food in there.
Nice.
Wow.
It's the archivist in me.
You don't have any. There are no original documents here, right?
Yeah.
All right, well, wonderful. Just as a reminder, under the terms of our charter, we meet up to four times per year. Our next meeting will take place on Tuesday, January 26, 2016. Also, as a reminder, our committee includes three subcommittees, FOIA oversight and accountability, proactive disclosures, and FOIA fees. Our subcommittees may schedule meetings in addition to the larger committee meetings. Because the subcommittees report to the full committee, the subcommittees do not have the same notice and open meeting requirements as the full committee. The committee's designated federal officer, Krista, must be present at all subcommittee meetings, and for record-keeping purposes, members should copy her on all communications concerning committee and subcommittee activities. This is a committee on the freedom of information, so accordingly, we want our work to be as open, transparent, and participatory as possible. So for updates on the committee's activities, please follow our blog at foia.blogs.archives.gov and follow us on Twitter. We welcome and encourage the public to submit written comments and suggestions for the FOIA Advisory Committee by email, mail, or fax. And the committee's contact information is available on our website as well. We're glad to see so many interested folks in the room, and we want you to be as much part of this committee as possible. We have set aside time at the end of the meeting for public comment. We look forward to hearing from any non-committee members who wish to comment at that time. Okay. We will now do the approval of minutes. I believe the committee members have had a chance to review a copy of the July 21st, 2015 meeting minutes. We sent those electronically, and I believe you have a copy in front of you as well. Are there any corrections to the minutes? All right. If not, then we'll now entertain a motion to approve the minutes. Do we have a motion?
I move that we approve the minutes.
Thank you. Do we have a second? So all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, anyone opposed? All right, the minutes will be approved, thank you. Okay, so now we're gonna spend the majority of this meeting hearing from each of the subcommittees on your work. We'll spend 30 minutes on each subcommittee's report, including a report of where the work stands and any discussion or brainstorming you would like to have with fellow committee members. We want to ensure we have a clear path forward for the coming months as we continue working to make recommendations to improve FOIA as directed in the second Open Government National Action Plan. So let's hear from the Proactive Disclosure Committee. Eric Gillespie and Brett Evett are the co-chairs of that subcommittee, and I'll ask them to report on their activity.
All right, good morning. This is Brent Evett here, and Eric Gillespie is on the phone. Eric, can you hear us?
I can, thank you.
Okay, well, Eric and I are now in our second, here today, our second full committee meeting as the co-chairs of the Proactive Disclosure Committee. And we came here in July and talked about where we were thinking our committee's work was headed. We talked about two goals that we had. One was to explore the role of the statute and the regulations in encouraging, enabling, mandating, however you wish to describe it, the work of FOIA officers across the government in making proactive disclosures. The second thing we were going to look at was the role of technology, the way that technological fixes could help us achieve this goal. The July committee meeting was very helpful to us because it allowed us to add some meat to the bones and sort of it gave us more to talk about under each of these categories. You know, we have discussed the position that FOIA officers are in, that natural tension between wanting to reduce the backlog and wanting to make proactive disclosures, and the fact that, at least in my experience with the FOIA community, I've never come across a FOIA officer who didn't think this was a good idea, proactive disclosures. But in the tug of war, often proactive disclosures lose. So we were talking, we've discussed how the regulations particularly encourage proactive disclosures, how reporting helps, and what can be done to encourage this across the FOIA community. I think we, you know, very clear steps have been taken, and I think there are probably gains that have been made as a result of that. But we're asking ourselves now, what more could be done? What have we learned from that experience, and what can help us encourage this in the future? There is, I think, reluctance, at least on my part, to do anything that that overreaches. I wouldn't want to create a regulation, for example, in my own agency that we couldn't achieve. So that's the tension. That's what was the element that was added to our discussion after the July meeting, is, you know, how far can a rule go to encourage this, and what benefit is there to that? We also talked about what we've called the low-hanging fruit. You know, there are clearly categories of records out there that the public is interested in, and agencies could focus on releases of those types of records. And Eric had some cool technological fixes to figuring out, you know, what is actually sought in the, you know, by FOIA requesters. But at the July meeting, we added to that the concern that if you go completely in that direction and you start focusing your proactive disclosure efforts on what is popular, then you miss what is, you know, out there in the agencies that may not be popular right now but may be very important. So it's almost like you have to burn that candle at both ends. You have to figure out how to do both. You know, there was a discussion in July about whether there had been any data to show that proactive disclosures actually reduced the number of incoming FOIA requests. And I haven't myself been able to find anything that really answers that question one way or the other. It's, you know, getting back to the question of prioritizing our work with proactive disclosures, it seems logical to me that, you know, if you could hit popular themes, you might reduce the number of incoming FOIA requests. But as far as I know, no one knows the answer to that right now, but I'm open if anyone has any data. But regardless of whether it does reduce the number of incoming FOIA requests, I think proactive disclosures can be very important to the statute, and it can certainly further the goals of the FOIA. Now, when it comes to the tech question, I think we've now realized that there are almost two questions here. There are big technology fixes that we could discuss, you know, agencies redoing entire FOIA processing systems where you would build in a very quick proactive disclosure mechanism. You know, you finish processing FOIA request, you press a button, and it goes off to the reading room or goes off to the internet. That's a long-term, big-dollar sort of fix. You know, for most agencies, that's probably at least a 5-year process, I would say, to procure a new system. But Erica has led the discussion that there could be a lot of little tech fixes too. You know, there maybe are existing commercial fixes that are out there that could be layered onto what we're doing that could help get information out there into the public's hands. We've also talked about the fact that others out there are working on this same concept. I know Bobby from DOJ came and talked to us last time about the release to one, release to all initiative. And we heard in July that the Food and Drug Administration also has done some good work in this area by actually predicting what people are going to be interested in and trying to get ahead of that. So, and there was a comment in July that maybe the General Services Administration has done some work in this area too, but I haven't been able to track that down yet. So, at this point, what we're going to focus on, and again, this is subject to discussion here, is figuring out what others have done, learning from the work of others like DOJ, OIP. We'd like to come in and talk to Melanie and Bobby and see what OIP has learned. And then perhaps start with a small agency and talk to their FOIA staff and see what their views are as a small agency looking at the concept of proactive disclosures. My agency has volunteered to be the one that we meet with, and that may very well be what we do. And we'd also like to look at a large agency and sit down with them and say, okay, what are your challenges when it comes to proactive disclosures? At the moment, we think we know what the challenges are, but we may be wrong. We may be seeing it from only our own perspective. And then we'd also like to just, as I mentioned, check around and see what GSA and FDA may have done that we could learn from. So that's it. That's the report of the Proactive Disclosures Committee. I'll open up the floor if anybody has any comments.
So I have a question, Brent. When you looked at the different agencies, did you take into account the kind of records that are associated with the agency based on their mission? For example, at DHS, the majority of the FOIA requests that we receive are for immigration-related records, right? So that's information that we would not ever proactively disclose.
That's right.
But when I was working at the Department of Commerce, the Department of Commerce doesn't get a lot of FOIA requests because most of the information based on the mission of that agency that they produce, they proactively post. Either in statistical tomes or other documents. And my other comment is, what about specific things that departments and agencies can do? Like, for example, draft documents. Because I understand that the requester community gets quite upset when we B5 draft documents and we don't release them, or we don't release them proactively, or we don't even release them after we've posted a final document. What are your thoughts about that?
Okay, this is Brent again. I think, Dolores, you're right. It's going to depend on the agency, how easy it is to do proactive disclosures. I mentioned the Food and Drug Administration. I know from years of co-teaching with Fred Sadler that, you know, they are very active in trying to figure out what the requester community is going to be interested in the future. And perhaps their mission makes that a little more doable because they know what their scientists are working on at the moment. So they know when they make, you know, they approve a drug, they know that's going to be a big topic. And that may not be possible for other agencies. For my agency, for example, we sometimes have a little advanced warning, but it's usually a day or two of advanced warning. So you can't do much strategic planning for proactive disclosure with a day or two of warning. The Exemption 5 draft issue, I think, is one that vexes all of us in the government because, obviously, you know, we all see draft documents withheld, you know, when they come across our desk for review. I don't know. I think the committee for us, I think the committee is going to have more discussion about whether that is a big issue for us as we talk about writing a report. I think it is a big issue in the FOIA community, without a doubt. And certainly I'd love to see more disclosure of draft material when there is no basis for withholding under Exemption 5. There's no harm. So.
I guess I have a quick question. So when we are discussing the idea of that proactive disclosure might reduce the number of FOIA requests that we would receive, you know, federal agency would receive, do we have any idea the number of hits or visits to these types of records that are being posted online? I know that we released all policy, that is something that is being tracked. Have you guys asked for any of the agencies to kind of give any kind of metrics regarding libraries?
Well, this is Brent again. That would be a good idea for the committee, actually, because maybe that would give us some data. If we know, for example, that an agency is making a certain level of effort to make proactive disclosures, and they have seen the number of hits on their reading room website increase tenfold during that period, and maybe even if they've seen the number of incoming FOIA requests drop, or at least stay stable, maybe that's data right there that one affects the other.
This is Melanie. That's, I mean, part of what we're doing in our pilot is looking at just that because of the tension that you talked about between taking time to proactively disclose records and the concern that that's taking away time for processing. So the reason we're doing the pilot is to actually try to get metrics, because we all want more proactive disclosures. We all think it's a good thing, even separate and apart from whether it reduces FOIA requests. It's just a good, because it's just a natural part of what the purpose of the Freedom of Information Act is. But we did think, because there's this tension, because we don't have unlimited numbers of people to do the posting, that it's helpful to know, okay, when we take time to post, are people actually looking at the records and what are they doing? So one of the series of metrics that we're capturing is are actually hits to the posted material, so that we could start to see if agencies could identify, well, when we post this kind of stuff, we get lots of hits. And even if it doesn't decrease requests for that information, at least you know people are looking at what you're posting, and so that's a good reinforcement to continue posting that material. And then maybe conversely, we would see certain kinds of things are not really getting hits. And so maybe we thought they were of interest to the public, but they're really not. So in a cost-benefit analysis, it's better to put our resources toward posting other kinds of things. So I mean, we're hoping to gather that kind of data that will help drive this a little bit better through our pilot.
So this is Sean. I mean, I think it's useful to at least look at this, but I would caution us from putting too much weight on how many hits something is getting in a kind of cost-benefit analysis. Sometimes information gets picked up by one or just a few individuals who then re-disseminate it, either through articles or through larger newsletters. And so a lot of people are actually benefiting from the disclosure. They're just not coming to that particular web page to see it. And the other thing is, sometimes this information may not be getting hits at the time, but things, situations can change. One of the pieces of information we've long said should be like sort of mandatory for all agencies are top-level official calendars. And again, not every secretary's calendar is going to get looked at every month, but say a high-level official runs for higher office, like a former Secretary of State who runs for president, they might be very interested in that calendar as they are now, and if that information had been proactively disclosed, it would be out there instead of there being FOIA fights right now. So there are going to be those situations too where the information's not getting many hits, but then you might know or expect that situations could change, and being proactive about it puts the agency and the whole government in a better light that it's already out there.
No, I agree with all of that. I also think that the sort of the other piece of this is we really need to have the ability, this is maybe where the tech side of your work on your subcommittee, Brent, could be helpful, is the ability to find this stuff. Because the more we put out there, if you can't easily find the records, now a calendar is maybe not so hard to find, but like you said, agencies could be putting things out that 5 years from now we're like, oh wow, we really want to gather all the data on that topic. We need to be able to find it. And I know at one of our best practices workshops, that the one we had last year on proactive disclosures, one of the things I asked the panelists were, or maybe it was with the requesters, I asked requesters, so maybe it was a requester panel, do you typically first look at what's already posted before you make a FOIA request? Like, do you actually look first to see? And the answer was, well, actually, no. Because it's just easier to make a request. So I was, I was really stunned by that. But at the same time, I thought, well, maybe that's showing you that it's not so easy to find things that are posted. And if you can't easily first find them, then you're going to default to making a request because you know how to do that, and that's at least the request making is fast.
Well, that's one of the things that we've talked about. Not all the FOIA websites are, really easy to navigate, right? So it can be a challenge to find the information on our website. So
well, this is Brent again. I think, you know, Dolores was talking about how each agency can be very different. And, you know, when you get to the tech question, each agency is very different too. Each website is different. You know, some agencies like mine, as I said in July, have a huge air gap between our system and the rest of the world for a very good reason. You know, and then other agencies are already right there on the edge. You know, they can post to the internet almost immediately if they had the technical means to do it.
This is Nate Jones from National Security Archive. First, I wanted to just underline something that Melanie said. And separate from hopefully reducing the workload and making people hopefully search and click and download the documents rather than refiling FOIA requests, there's another very good reason that we touched on that proactive posting is so important, and that's the having a government that operates on the presumption of openness and having as much information out there to have as informed a citizenry as possible. So even beyond that, that's the other reason we're doing it. I don't think we're just doing it to reduce workloads or backlogs, though I take that, hey, we're nuts and bolts world. And after that, I just have two comments and one question for the subcommittee. The comments are, first of all, on the issue of big technology and it's hard for agencies to get the big fix to easily push a button and release eventually somehow the documents onto the internet. Well, I would say that I hope that some of the tech companies that are making FOIA software are hearing this subcommittee saying we need a solution, and I think I hear that people may be willing to pay for this. And I hope that they're running, not walking, to make a technological solution that makes it easier for the agencies to post documents online and makes them searchable easily from Google. And my second comment, along the lines of what Sean said, is that another good thing that would be proactively posted and easy to find on the FOIA website is a kind of roadmap of where the documents are. A record retention schedule, I believe, is already mandated to be posted online, but those are often very hidden. And even then, some of them are very good, some of them not so much. So another category that I would like to see every FOIA page have front and center is a roadmap of where the documents are, what's held off at the Washington Records Center, what's easy to find, an index so that requesters know what they can request. Now, having said that, does that mean that you might have more FOIA requests? Maybe, but I still think that would be a good thing if the public knows what the government knows about how their records are filed and stored. And then my last question, the subcommittee has spoken earlier about the issue of 508 compliance with the Rehabilitation Act. And I remember a meeting, I think about a year ago, the Proactive Disclosure Subcommittee gave a very good report, I thought, that said essentially it should be, in this day and age, one, most records should already be created 508 compliant. That actually is the law, not posting. And two, even if they're not, it should be fairly easy to post them. So my question, and it's a leading question, but I'm hopeful that the lack of not bringing up 508 compliance means that this hurdle is beginning to become overcome, and that 508 compliance is no longer the big reason why more documents aren't posted online.
All right, this is Brent again. You know, the honest answer is I don't know where we stand with the 508 compliance question. I know the discussion has been going for a while. As Eric and I came to be co-chairs of the Proactive Disclosure Subcommittee, we have not made that a center point of our discussion. We will take that back to the subcommittee and see if maybe we should be discussing it. I know it has been discussed in the past. I know it is a problem.
Thanks.
This is Mark. This is working. I want to echo some of the thoughts, or at least I'll say I agree with Sean and Nate. And one issue, obviously, you guys are going to have are figuring out some way to measure the metrics of this. I'm thinking of some possible ways, and perhaps one way that could be searchable from within each FOIA office is to have the FOIA officers indicate how often in their responses to FOIA requests are they saying or referring people to their website for whether or not there are documents that are responsive. I think I've given an example before. If you send NSA a record for UFOs, they'll just say, go look at our website, we don't have any records. Or I'm sure there's other indications where they'll say, you know, go look at our website, here are all your records before we start processing. that at least may be something that's searchable by FOIA officers rather than looking at hits or dissemination of documents.
Okay, thank you, Mark. This is Brent again. So right now, we plan to have a full subcommittee meeting in November. I'm hoping, and we'll work with Krista to try to make that happen. Right now, we have, of course, Eric Gillespie and I are co-chairs. Dolores, Marty, David, and Sean, I think, have agreed to work with the subcommittee. Anyone else who would like to is certainly welcome. And we will reach out to you, Melanie, if that's okay, and see if we can get on your calendar to talk to you.
This is Sean Moulton with POGO again. One other thought that I wanted to raise. You talked about regulation and technology, and I think there might be a third piece. Maybe it fits in the technology, but so I'll just bring it up and we can figure out how it fits and whether or not we could address it. But I think one of the things for proactive disclosure that we should be thinking and talking about is record creation with an eye towards disclosure. And I know there's a lot going on from the archives and electronic records management, and hopefully we can fit into that. But I also know that at the last meeting, I think it was Marty that talked about the contracts for a Consumer Financial Protection Bureau and how they kind of preemptively structured them so that they would be more releasable. And I think it's the kind of policy, or at least preference, that we could start to build into record creation that could make a big difference down the line in terms of whether or not they're easily releasable or not. Maybe some of this B5 stuff could be decided ahead of time, so there's a lot that can be released. And there's a smaller piece that's B5 that we can fight over with a FOIA request, but if people really want to. But if we can get a lot of material out and make it easier, it makes a lot of sense. So.
All right, thanks, Sean. This is Brent again. I think that's a good point. I think that actually fits in our first, the first part of our mission, the rules, regulations, and procedures of the agency. It was a great discussion in July that, you know, if you get a lot of requests for contracts, it can be very helpful to build into your process and understanding with the companies that you deal with about how you're going to handle their contract documents. And I think there are many other gains you could make along those lines. And this may be what we would consider that low-hanging fruit. For example, if your agency publishes a series of documents or has a certain type of information that it always produces, and you can think about that beforehand and you can plan for what would happen when you're processing that for release. I think that can be very helpful if you can actually educate the people who are creating the information. Now, I think there is a limit to how successful you're going to be in doing that. I mean, I don't think we're going to be able to very quickly make great gains in that area, but certainly in a few categories, we could make some gains.
I think, this is Molly, I think that, Jim, didn't DLA, I think it was DLA, a couple years ago, yes, set up a whole system for having contractors provide like a publicly releasable version, mm-hmm, of contracts so that could be posted right away. Mm-hmm. And then sure, people could, it's sort of like you're saying, like if you really wanted to kind of get into the nitty gritty and go back and forth about whether a B4 call was right or not, yes, you could do that, submit a notice and all that could happen. But for the vast majority of people, there would at least be something available like immediately that had the B4, at least a first cut of B4, already taken out. And it seemed like that we were, yes, already seeing some of that.
I think it's got, I think the Defense Health Agency also, I believe, has some kind of process going on. Of course, the difficulty is without FOIA exemption, you can't use Executive Order 12600 to process there. That's a guarantee. It's exactly, what we're getting. And each agency will, may have different processes. It helps, and it does tend to have a tendency to reduce FOIA requests. I think so. I haven't really looked at it too much to see how good the results are, but it has helped the agencies. So.
Mind if I jump in here? I'm sure you're not on the committee, but obviously we've been chatting a lot about these different issues, and I think that one thing we need to keep in mind is that the issue of proactive disclosure. bigger than FOIA. Mm-hmm. We're talking about records management. We're talking about IT. We're talking about contracting and procurement. We're talking about 508. We're talking about all these different units within an organization. So one thing I want to challenge the subcommittee to do is just kind of think of what's doable, what's reasonable, what, you know, you're looking at this huge universe of things, and I think you'll probably have to narrow it down to something. So I think that's something to think about. And, you know, I'm thinking of things from the requester's perspective and from the agency's perspective. And our role as FOIA ombudsman at OGIS, we hear from requesters, and we know that they want records, and we know that they want them to be proactive disclosed. But another issue that we're hearing about is the idea of education. How do we empower requesters to look at agency FOIA websites and find the records that have already been publicly released so that agencies don't have to duplicate their work, so agencies can work more efficiently? So part of that is agencies will need to improve, well, you may find that agencies need to improve their websites. I think an important point that Melanie raised is it's not enough to put this information up. It needs to be searchable and discoverable and crawlable, and that's an IT issue. You know, the program offices need to talk with the FOIA offices and vice versa. You've got the records management issue, and you know, Sean referenced Marty's comments at our previous meeting, is, you know, the idea that records management and disclosure, it needs to be built into a record. A record, you think of the classified world where, you know, paragraphs are portion marks, so you know right away what can ultimately hopefully be disclosed and what can't be. So, I mean, one thing that might be useful to agencies, they come to us, they want to know how to do it, and I mean, I think the takeaway from this committee won't be, oh, use this product, but it might be, you know, gathering a list of what practices agencies are using to proactively disclose things. What are the elements of a good proactive disclosure program? And so it's not just going to be about FOIA, it'll be bigger than that. But, you know, I think, you know, what's doable? You know, you and Eric have mentioned the low-hanging fruit. I mean, this isn't going to be an issue that this committee solved, but what can you do that will be valuable to requesters and to agencies? So, you know, maybe some more education, improving websites, but also, you know, what's doable? Can we add to OIP's proactive disclosure best practices? What can we do? I think it's a really great topic. I hope more of the committee will get involved. And I also think it's really interesting because, you know, OIP, it's doing its release to one, release to all thing, and I think it complements the work that Eric's been doing very well. I think there are, you know, there's the release to one, release to all approach, but there's also looking at it in a more strategic way, looking at it, analyzing the data from, you know, different agencies and seeing what records are in demand. And so when something comes up, you can deliberately make the effort to proactively disclose that. I mean, I think another great area where some agencies have had success is kind of having special projects that they do. So, you know, you have a Supreme Court nomination and then, you know, all the resources go into that and you get that out as quickly as possible. You know, there were agencies that released, you know, records in response to the BP oil spill. I mean, sometimes you don't know a record is in demand until some crisis or some event happens and then all resources go into that. So, I mean, there are different ways. There's the strategic approach, there are special projects to do, but, you know, I'm really excited for you to be working on this. I'm talking a lot longer than I thought I would, and I bet you're all amazed by this, but, you know, one of the elements of the U.S. government's second Open National Action Plan, I totally messed up the way that's the NAP, you know, it wasn't just the creation of a FOIA modernization committee, but one of the specific areas that we should be looking at and trying to address in some way, big or small, is the issue of proactive disclosure. So, you know, let's get our hands dirty, let's try and do something, and I hope, you know, those of you here will give us feedback. We hear it time and time again. There's not going to be a one answer fits all because agencies produce different records. They have different systems. There's not going to be an easy fix, but let's try and do something that will help
help us, you know, meet the needs of requesters and agencies. You're here.
Can I? This is David Ferriero. I just want to make some connections here with something Nate said and the records management discussion. We are up to our necks, as you know, in implementing the directive on managing government records. And part of that, part of our responsibility has been working with the industry to educate them, first of all, about what the needs are and to let them go away and start thinking about the tools that they can help us, that they can develop that will help us do our work. So an important piece of that is this FOIA responsibility and letting them know. We've already had one industry day. We're gearing up for another one. So it's important that the FOIA piece of it be part of what we talk to them about, and I promise to bring that to the table.
I just want to give one more quick kudos for another, I think, textbook example of proactive disclosure. The National Archives and Johnson Presidential Library just released a whole set of every PDB from Johnson and a little bit of Kennedy that was once called the most secret document created that would never be released. And National Security Archive might quibble with some of the redactions, and we're eager to see the rest of them released. But credit's due to the National Archives with some help from the CIA for posting a huge series of documents proactively that is a great resource and is getting lots of hits too.
And I would just flip your comments and give more credit to CIA than National Archives. It was Joe Lambert who really pushed this.
Great.
Okay, well, this is Brent again. Just to finish up our report, we recognize that we need to reach some conclusions that are, you know, a mix of idealistic and practical, and that can actually do some good. And we're going to need to start getting a report together here in the next few months. So, I invite anyone to join us as we do that. We will have a full subcommittee meeting in November.
Just to kind of articulate the next steps, you're going to wrap your hands around what you have, the discussion that we had today, and then you're going to write some kind of report with next steps as far as not necessarily recommendations, but where you kind of see us heading.
Yeah, this is Brent again. That's my plan. I have already done one email out to the committee, you know, trying to sort of capture where we are at this moment. I'll do another one after this meeting and then work with Krista to figure out when and where we can meet, and then try to get on Melanie's calendar.
So that's going to be kind of a reoccurring theme here, is I'm going to kind of push folks to tell me what the next steps are. You know, this, I'll mention it a couple times, but the charter is coming, you know, it's going to expire in May. Right? So we have one more meeting in January, and then pour it out, whatever it is, you know, the next steps are going to be. You know, we'll have further discussions about the charter, obviously, but I would like to push each subcommittee as hard as we can to come up with some of those key areas that we could move in a direction. So thank you very much. Let's now turn to the fee subcommittee, co-chaired by Nate Jones and Jim Hogan. I will turn it over to Nate.
All right, thank you very much. I have three main points I want to hit, and then plan to have the rest of the time for a discussion. So the three points are, first, I want to talk about our recent poll summary to federal workers. Second, I want to talk about how we get input from the public on FOIA fees. And third, next steps. So I think it's on the OGIS website, and everyone has a copy of a summary of our FOIA fees poll that we put together. And essentially, we wanted to get insight from government FOIA processors and FOIA requesters on fees. FOIA fees that, I remember our first meeting here, we called a huge source of FOIA acrimony. As we try and make them less acrimonious and try to fix them, we wanted to get input. So the first step that's come to fruition, and there's a great resource on the OGIS website, is the poll of federal FOIA processors. So over 407 responded. More than 75% have worked there for 3 years. More than 55% are hands-on FOIA processors, not kind of someone with the FOIA tag that doesn't get their hands dirty. These are very interesting results and very good results. I want to highlight two data points and then urge you guys to look at the data more closely because I think it's really good. So the first data point I just want to hit is that of the requests, about 20% of all requests report, 20% of all survey poll respondents said that they estimated that 20% of all FOIA requests are charged fees. I'll say that again. Only 20% of all FOIA requests our respondents said are charged fees. So that's an interesting data point. So next to the fact that we've said before that FOIA fees cover just 1% of all FOIA costs. And again, as we all know, that FOIA fees don't go to the agencies, they go to the general fund. So now we know that of all the FOIA requests that processors see, they say that only 20% end up being charged fees. The rest are news media fee status or fee waivers, or probably something we've talked about before, administrative discretion waivers. The other data point is that the majority of respondents to our survey said that using fees never or rarely resulted in requesters narrowing their requests. And we've spoken before that maybe that's a use of fees, but the data at least makes you raise your eyebrow. Those are just kind of the high-level reviews, and I should have said it earlier. The summary of the data was compiled by Maggie and Julia Matta, and it's thank you very much. But I would also urge for you guys to dig into the actual raw results, which I'm very glad are posted on OGIS's website. And especially I'd point you guys to question 6. And this is where FOIA processors that actually know FOIA and actually get their hands dirty, and it's not in the handout, you have to look online, actually spoke candidly, which they're often not allowed to do in the federal government. That's one thing I've been learning on the committee as a member from the public, is that a lot of people in the government have their hands tied and can't speak candidly. But I'd take a look at question 6. And if you really want to know what's up with FOIA fees, give a long read to the responses there. And there's some very telling responses. So we can come back to this later. But essentially, we have the data released on OGIS's website. We have a good summary by Julia and Maggie. And these responses will inform our subcommittee's work going forward. The second point, we wanted to also poll the public so we get both sides of the coin, but we've learned that due to logistical problems about doing polls and publishing results, that it is not going to be practical to do. So instead, the subcommittee, I think with some concern, has decided that we want to solicit comments directly to OGIS and OGIS's website from the public that we'll post. But rather than officially solicit them through a poll or a survey like we did with this, we want the public to just write in and say, tell us what you think we should do about FOIA fees. And I know that's a challenge. We had 400 federal FOIA officers tell us what they thought, and I would love to see that many public people write in. But know that even though we're not doing a poll to the public, we want to hear, and we will take your opinions into consideration. But finally, the last point. From talking with everyone on the subcommittee, we didn't join the FOIA Feeds subcommittee to do a bunch of polls. We've spoken from day one that we want to make actual improvements on FOIA fees, reduce the acrimony, and hopefully get more requests out to more people more quickly. Get more returns to more people more quickly. So with that vein, our next steps. After some discussion, we kept going back to what is the root of the problem. And what we found time and time again is that the real law, or the real advice, the law of the land, colloquially, about FOIA fees is this OMB FOIA fee guidance from the Federal Register, written in 1986, 1987. now. That's essentially before email was created. It's before the internet. It's before being able to send a FOIA response over a computer instead of printing out a big packet of documents and sending via postal mail. And it's also incomplete. Jim pointed out that it seems to be missing key words at key spots. So what our subcommittee has decided that what our tangible result to improve the process is we are going to recommend, I believe, to the archivist to recommend to above him to upgrade the FOIA fee thing from 1987. It's much needed. Now we're still working, and we don't want to just do the same thing and cross out the date and put a new one. We're working to have a set of consensus recommendations using the data from people inside the government and FOIA requesters of what can we all agree on that we can do to improve the FOIA fee process for this much needed update. And I'll leave it there and we can have some discussion.
So just for a point of clarity, Krista, you can correct me if I'm wrong.
I will.
I believe that the subcommittee will make a recommendation to the larger committee. The larger committee will then take a vote on how they would like to proceed and whether or not they are in agreement with the subcommittee's recommendation. Then based on that, the committee as a whole will make a recommendation on how we're going to proceed.
To clarify or add to Nate's comments, the reason we thought it would be best to informally gather data from the public about this issue is the survey, as you generated it, you know, it doesn't really qualify for OMB's 5-day fast track process. So,
right. So, it's
short reason bureaucracy.
Well, it's not that we can't do it. So I know that there was some hesitancy, right? But this was an issue that we were working on. And if the subcommittee felt strongly on this issue, we could go through the OMB clearance route. The only point is that by the time that we got some kind of determination, the committee's charter would probably have expired.
Yeah, the subcommittee understands and we want to use our resources other ways.
Right.
And so I would say, we welcome the public, as we always do, to comment informally, just write up your own experiences, or if you do want to post survey questions that you want people to specifically respond to or elaborate on their experiences, but that's definitely doable. It's something we can do.
So based on general counsel's guidance, obviously we're with the subcommittee, but on the advisory committee's webpage itself, there will be some kind of survey or some way of collecting the comments as you guys have drafted them.
But it wouldn't be like a survey instrument like SurveyMonkey. It would just be, a bunch of questions that we'd like people to respond to so we can better understand their experiences with the fees and the fee process.
But I do think you bring up a valid point about, who we're going to target or how we're going to get folks to go on there and make those comments. Obviously, there's going to have to be some kind of media blitz or, outreach that we do, stakeholder engagement to get a representative sample. Because obviously we don't just want, media requests, we want the individual experience, we want the full experience.
So while we're talking about procedural stuff, the subcommittee, as far as I understand, we've decided that we want to go ahead and recommend that we update the guidance at the next meeting, and we don't know, so should we vote on, should we pass it on now or pass it on to the next one, because we do know that time's a constraint. So we were starting to work to have a product, I think, by the next meeting. So what procedural things we need to do to make sure that we can deliver this product by the next meeting?
Two things. First, on what Krista was describing about putting on the OGIS website. I think your general counsel will advise you avoid use of the word survey, avoid talking about what listing questions, put it in terms of issues, inviting comments on the issues. But a question I'd like to ask, particularly prompted by reading of your poll results, has anybody looked into whether there's some legislative history as to what Congress thought would be the purpose of having fees, or what OMB in its guidance thought was the purpose of fees.
Jim did some great research on this, and I'll let him share it.
Okay, you'll notice something here. And this is from the preamble to the guidelines, and it says, while the legislative history of the 1974 amendments to the Freedom of Information Act shows that Congress did not intend that fees be erected as barriers to citizen access, it is quite clear that the Congress did intend that agencies recover of their costs. There's a missing word between recover and of. Again, Congress did intend that agencies recover of their costs. Some, most, half, we don't know what that word is.
Are the agencies getting to keep any of this money?
The agencies don't keep it. The money is...
So how
they recover costs. They don't.
So maybe there's a recommendation somewhere in that.
Well, and this is something I asked former director of OIP at the Cuff about 15 years ago, and somebody asked him, said, why can't agencies get it? And Dick was very wise. His answer was, if your bean counters knew that you're getting, say, $10,000 in from FOIA fees, what are they going to do to your budget? You're going to cut it $10,000, you're going to break even.
All of that makes sense. My point is simply that if there's a mismatch between the intended purpose of the fees and what's actually happening with the fees, maybe that's an area for recommendation.
And as you may say, congressional intent may have changed in the past 40 years, 50 years, of what to do with fees.
This is Melanie. I think actually, in some ways, ironically, the language about that Congress was intending agencies to recoup fees, when you match that against the reality that agencies are getting 1% of fees, I think Congress was intending that there'd be lots more charging of fees and recouping of fees than there actually is. It's really kind of ironic how it's panned out.
The one thing that I thought was particularly interesting about the survey that I felt relieved about to a great extent actually was the fact that there was, at least for this survey, the people who responded to the survey, the amount of time spent on fees was very small. I was really pleasantly surprised because I think a lot of us, sort of the lore or our perception was that, oh my God, the poor FOIA professionals are just spending hours and hours in diverting their time fussing over fee determinations.
Just 50% spend less than 1 hour a week, and only 7% spend 10 or more hours
a week. So it was a really pretty startling, but I thought, I mean, that to me was really a powerful thing for us to know that, and obviously, I mean, the survey, to the extent of, we capture a certain group of people, I know it's not statistically necessarily exactly, that you can predict it out, but I found that result a really very powerful thing. And I just think it should help our thinking that it's, okay, so maybe it's not so much that we want to focus on reducing time spent. We want to focus, so what is it that we want to focus on? Clarity of the requirements. Or another thing, the second thing that struck me was it seemed like a lot of people mentioned the desire to have more training on fees. And so, I mean, that was certainly something that resonated with us because we did a fee summit before. And so for me, just looking at that, and I'm happy to talk with the committee, like what further things we can do for training. We're happy to start doing that kind of thing as soon as we can.
This is Dave Barr. And regarding that, the point about the time spent on fee issues, I think it's important to know, and this underscores my frustration that we can't really effectively poll the requester community, that whereas the FOIA staff may not think that they're spending a significant amount of time on the fee issue, I can speak from personal experience on my client's behalf that as far as the requester community goes, fees are a very, very predominant issue. And I don't know if the reason that FOIA staff doesn't spend a lot of time on fees overall is because the vast majority of FOIA requests are from the commercial requester community where fees are a given, and therefore there's no dispute. I can't speak to that, but I know that from, as I said, from personal experience, my clients have definitely been confronted with fees where they were forced to either withdraw their request or significantly narrow the scope of the request that, for the information that they had a right to have access to. And it'd be very unfortunate that the bureaucratic barriers to asking the requester community are going to leave a very large void of information for the committee to work with, because the process has been skewed to make it very easy for us to ask the internal FOIA staff their views. And the other comment I wanted to make is I was disheartened to find that the primary reason, and this is regarding question six on our survey, that the responses to question six, the majority of people who thought fees should be retained primarily based that opinion on the ability to use fees in a coercive nature to force people, or try to force people, to seek less information from the government than they originally thought. And the FOIA text does not speak to using fees in a coercive nature. It speaks to fee recovering fees, the reasonable fees, or fees reasonably tied to the cost of actual production of the information, and not as a tool to force people to narrow the request. We all know that that's a common use of this, and the response to the survey has ratified that. The final point I'd make is, I forget who it was just a moment ago, mentioned that 1% of the fees recovered are going to the agencies, and I just want to underscore that that's a misunderstanding, that even though we're recovering only 1% of the fees, or 1% of the cost of producing the information, none of that money, not a single penny, is going back to the agencies. In effect, the agencies are spending time, staff time, and money recovering fees that are going into the general fund and not coming back to them. So it's a net loss, regardless of how much time the agencies spend, to the agencies whenever they ask for fees and have to deal with fees. Thank you.
Thanks, Dave.
Can I jump in here? Is this on? Thank you. Mr. Pritzker, I just want to respond to your comments regarding the verbiage we might include with anything we post or publish online with regard to our attempts to gather more information about the public experience with fees. I mean, we are in contact with our Office of General Counsel, and that's a great reminder that we should, run anything that we have by them, so we're using all the right buzzwords and not saying the words we shouldn't say. Dave Barr, I think you raise an interesting point, and I think that's something you should bring back to your fellow subcommittee members, and it's kind of an issue that Melanie touched on too, the issue of how much time requesters spend dealing with fees issue. I'm sure Melanie sees this with agencies when they do training. I know at OGIS we see this when we work with agencies and when we work with requesters. There's a lot of misunderstanding when it comes to fees, especially with regards to the issue of fee waivers and fee categories, and people don't always get that. So that's definitely an issue. And Dave, I'd say if you think that's an issue that should be raised in whatever we post to gather information to learn more about requesters' experiences, bring that, and we could definitely include that in anything we post to solicit feedback on this issue.
I have just one general comment, and I talked with Ann about this a while ago, but in our regulations, we have given the FOIA manager administrative discretion to waive fees. And I would say that the vast majority of non-commercial requesters, I've waived pretty much as a standard practice now. So what I've done, and you'll see this probably, I think, by the end of the year, when our regulation update goes out for public comment, but we've now instituted that in our regulation that we've raised thresholds away from the $25. We've made them higher. We've made the prepayment limit higher. And that was all in an attempt to take some of the work that the subcommittee had commented on, as well as the survey results, and just a good practice of getting information out there to non-commercial requesters. So we've taken that approach, and you'll see it probably in the regulation by the end of the year. I think we're planning on getting that out.
Thanks, Marty. That reminds me, two other related issues that the subcommittee is working on is this issue of administrative discretion in FOIA fees, and also the issue of when can FOIA fees be charged and to whom if the request goes over the 20 or 30 day deadline per the 2007 Open Government Act. So those are two other issues that we're also digging into.
So I guess the next steps, I mean, that was kind of one of your leading questions, right?
Yeah, I got a lot of those.
Yeah, it sounds like you guys have done a lot of work and that you have several recommendations that you're going to vote out of your own subcommittee. You guys are in agreement between the recommendations?
I think we've already voted out of the subcommittee that we want to recommend that to the archivist that the OMB guidelines be changed.
And that's the...
Our subcommittee already has agreed to that. And so, however it happens that we can keep moving forward at the next meeting, I don't know when we have to have a vote on that, but...
Are you recommending new language for OMB to issue or just recommendation that new language needs to be issued? That's where I'm a little bit confused.
I don't know if that's something we would leave up to OMB. We can get to the guts of that so much. Primarily, I'm thinking I want them to look at in light of the realities of the changing world. And the biggest issue is whether and thank you for National Security Archive back in 1988 for suing the Department of Defense is whether how an organization qualifies as a representative news media, and that is very troubling. Even case law is changing on that. Even recent an opinion came out of the Circuit Court here in D.C. It may have changed things a little bit. Don't know, but. In light of that, and the whole world of journalism has changed. It's different than it was 20, 30 years ago. I don't call it a crisis in a profession, but I've heard that term, but it's a different profession in some ways. You know, how do you define that profession? And so then what is the true congressional intent when it comes down to who qualifies for the favored fee category? And have OMB, I think, to relook at that and say, okay, here's the reality of the world, here's how it's changed. And it may be, the answer may be something agencies will have trouble living with. That's a risk I have to take. It could be saying, here's a new world. I think congressional intent is different than it was 40 years ago when it comes to agencies recouping fees or whatever, government recouping fees, whoever recoups the fees. It's definitely changed. And I'm not familiar with the congressional language for the change in 2007, the Open Government Act, but I think there's some discussion there about, because they brought in the National Security Archive opinion and codified it. So. I'm thinking of just saying, OMB, here's what you want you to look at and how you redo it.
Okay.
Be up to you, I think.
Right. I mean, the challenge of media requesters, I mean, you have corporations and law firms now saying, oh, we are the public, we write a newsletter, so therefore we feel we believe media status. Is there suing an agency on behalf of a client? So those are the challenges, you're correct. It's tough in today's world.
And I think, I mean, I've said this before, and... can the National Football League qualify as representative news media in accordance with recent case law? They have
say yes. Get some data on concussions.
Oh yeah. Publish. See, they have. Well,
there was
they
a
have.
Case with the
they,
military.
They have a. They have a cable network. They have reporters. They have a blog. They have all those things where people. And Sean's shaking his head. Yes, and I know Pogo's is an example of one. Yeah, National Football League qualifies. Okay. Is that where we want to go? Is that where the requesters want to go? I don't know. But it seems to be that's where it's going. Now that's I have been able to be frank and open, and despite what you're saying, some of the employees are out. I am in that position. I am. That's the concern. That's mine. My concern, or just an observation, I'd say, where we're going fees.
I would just add that. Any change that no one from the requester community, and I don't think anyone from the government community would want the OMB guidelines to change to prohibit more requesters. I think we want them to be in the spirit of President Obama and the Attorney General's instructions on FOIA and the presumption of disclosure. And I am certain that the archivist would agree with that as well.
Okay. comments, general thoughts? So, I mean, I think that there's two options here, right? I mean, you could bring a motion forward right now, make a recommendation, which the full committee can then vote on. Or we could table the conversation, noodle on it a little bit, and then you guys could submit something a little bit more formal, as in, you know, the language that you would actually like the recommendation to read to the archivist.
Mrs. Melanie, it seems like for people, since we haven't done this yet, we haven't had a vote for the committee, it seems like just maybe my caution as a lawyer that normally you would have something in writing that we could look at, and then we could all, and it'd be nice to have it in advance so that then we're ready to vote, as opposed to just kind of doing it on the fly.
Sure, and I guess we just wanted to, but do we have to have that in writing next meeting, or can we have it before next meeting?
So that we could.
So that we could actually do something.
So you want to vote on it prior to the next meeting? Is that kind of the implication?
Well, I think Tom and working backwards, timing wise, right? You guys know.
Could people just sort of give their consensus on how they feel about the position, about a recommendation at NAR, update there? This way, at least you'll have sort of an informal consensus knowing where everybody's going, vis-a-vis going through the formal process that Melanie recommends, which I would agree with. Because, I mean, I've clearly been saying for years it's time to update the OMB fee guidance. So, I mean,
I do think there's a nuance there, right? Because what we kind of heard from both sides a little bit was this broadening of the media category, and do we want OMB's guidance to kind of restrict that a little bit? And what I kind of heard from Nate was, no, we want to make sure that we're as broad as we can. So, I mean, what exactly is the recommendation? It seems to me that the recommendation is
to update the guidance. I mean, neither Jim nor I is going to write the guidance.
Or anyone else.
Yeah, I don't think we have a good idea exactly what we're going to recommend to them. Even by the next meeting, I think we have something really written up, because once we get this informal survey, I'd almost be rushing it, I'm thinking. I don't know, Nate may disagree, and that's fine. But we can have, we definitely want to go forward with something. But we definitely have to see what the public tells us, I think, before we go to that.
One thing that I think the sort of the more simple the formulation is, like, then the easier it is to move forward on, like something like, recommended it be updated. I think regardless, it's notice and comment rulemaking, and the phrasing could actually make sure that you take into account with rulemaking and commenting and input from civil society and things like that. But it seems, I just think it's always it's just easier to be able to look at, even if it's just a short, simple. I think the simpler it is, the easier it will be.
Okay, yeah,
like two sentences.
Something simple is easy enough for next meeting. Yes.
You know, not some big report or something, but just something really simple.
Does everyone feel comfortable kind of?
I don't feel comfortable with the last thing that Melanie
no,
said.
Okay. Uh-huh.
Because what that, given what's been said in the last several minutes, that sounds a little too abbreviated along the line. I think it's useless to say to OMB that you should update your guidance without telling them what the problems are. We don't have to write language for them. We shouldn't write language for them. But for example, talking about the evolution of the concept of media or journalism, other issues, the way that the growth of the internet and government record keeping has changed in the 30 years since then. We ought to be, in our recommendation, identifying where the problems are and what it is that needs to be updated without telling them how to do it. But I think just to say it's time to update your guidance would be useless.
I don't disagree. I totally agree. I think what we're just talking about is two different things. Like what you just described, I think would be like the background. Here's the issue. Here's the facts. Here's what's
something
changed.
Like what a report would look like.
Like what a report would look like, and then the actual recommendation that people would vote on could be something very simple.
But the
straightforward is what I'm trying to say. Maybe that's a better word than simple.
But identifying these issues, at least in my view, ought to be more than just the background. That's part of the, I think that should be part of the recommendations. You can say such as, or including, for example, but I think that it's important to identify where the problems are, even if
and
we don't
what
have
the
a
need
solution.
Would be, what forms the basis for making the recommendation.
Yes.
Yeah, I agree totally.
My opinion, speaking for myself, is that the subcommittee is ready to do that. What is the process of officially getting the permission to do that so that we can give a deliverable before our tenure expires?
Well, I think that Larry had a good point. I mean, do you want to do like kind of a consensus to see where we kind of lie on the issue? And then in January, that you would submit some kind of written product, whether you know as a white paper or it's some type of report laying out all these issues that have been brought up and with the specific recommendation that we can then all read and take a vote on.
Sure.
And as long as you get that to Krista, she can handle the agenda, make a new agenda.
Not at the last minute.
And then if we can get it out to folks a little bit before.
Yeah.
So that way, if there's any amendments to it. All right,
so that's going to make sure we do it.
Yeah,
let's.
Should
we move or?
I don't think, since we're just doing a poll, I mean, this is just an informal poll about your inclination on this recommendation, that this is something that you're inclined to go forward with as a full committee. In favor of recommending to OMB?
Here, here.
Aye.
Yes. Yeah. I think this is a solid recommendation, one that we can definitely move forward, you know, together. It's great.
It's going to be really what the specific background material is and how, you know, because I mean, clearly that's a difficult part. The recommendation to change the fee guidelines that are almost 30 years old is an easy one. It's really what's the background material say, and how that would affect. So that's the tough part. To be honest with you, the easy part is we need to do something.
All right, so I think we're in a really good position. I don't know how everyone feels on the committee, but I feel it's a good start. All right, so we're going to go ahead and take a 15-minute break, and then we'll reconvene. In 15 minutes, 11:45, right?